first question is, for this lecture, is there such a thing as a nociceptor? So I told you guys in the lecture the other day that these things do exist, right? We have a definition for them. So obviously, it's true, but this was actually a area of huge scientific controversy not so terribly long ago. So in the 1940s, 1950s, and 1960s, this was really an area of intense investigation, and it didn't really get settled until the 1970s due to a very, very famous electrophysiologist named Ed Pearl, who started his career at the University of Utah and then worked at the University of North Carolina for a really long time. He actually passed away two years ago, I think now. He was in his 90s. He's also the founder of the Society for Neuroscience. So you guys probably have heard of Society for Neuroscience, right? This is the professional organization of neuroscientists. It has a meeting every year called the Society for Neuroscience meeting. The one last year was in Washington, D.C. Anybody go to that meeting, by the way, in this room? No? Okay. Well, hopefully this year, some of you will go. Andy, you went, didn't you?
Yeah.
I thought I saw you there. So hopefully this year, some of you guys will go to that meeting. We actually have a scholarship here, the Larry Collar Scholarship, that's specifically to send undergraduate students in neuroscience to meetings to present the work that they're doing in laboratories. So if you guys are working in a lab and you want to present a poster, Society for Neuroscience is a great meeting to go to, and you can apply for the Larry Collar Scholarship, and we'll give you $750 to cover your travel expenses. So it's a cool thing, and the meeting is a lot of fun. There's 30,000 neuroscientists there, posters from people from all over the world. It's like Christmas for neuroscientists. So anyway, this society, one of its founders was Ed Pearl, and Ed Pearl was the preeminent scientist at the time in the 70s. He remained a preeminent scientist in lots of different areas, mostly related to pain and nociception throughout his entire career. He was productive up until the year that he died, still publishing papers, so he was actively working in his lab into his 90s, which is amazing. I'm not sure if I want to do that or not, but you know, be cool if I could. So he contributed an enormous amount to this, so I'm going to talk a little bit about the work that he did. The question here is, though, how does the sensory system encode information? And there were two competing theories at the time that this area of work was really developing. Those were the intensity theory and the specificity theory. So the intensity theory basically posited that all of the sensory neurons that innervate your body, okay, all are capable of encoding any type of stimulus, be it mechanical, thermal, whatever, right? But that the signal that they send to the nervous system is finally decoded by the brain based on the intensity of the signal, right? So if you're just sitting in your chair and nothing's really bothering you, and you know somebody tickles you with a feather, your neurons would fire a couple of action potentials, whereas if you're sitting in the chair and somebody hits you with a hammer, those neurons would fire action potentials intensely. And all of them would basically respond the same way, and the decoding that would happen in the brain would be based on the number of action potentials, basically the incoming signal, right? So the opposing concept related to this was that it's not about intensity at all, but rather about specificity. So what does that mean? That means that you should have neurons that respond specifically to light touch. You should have neurons that respond maybe specifically to temperature or changes in temperature, heating or cooling. You should have neurons that respond specifically to pruritogens, so things that cause itch, like histamine, etc., which we'll talk about somewhat in this class. And also neurons that respond to pain stimuli, which before we knew that they were nociceptors, they were theoretically called nociceptors. But it was really in the 60s and 70s the work of Ed Pearl that figured this out. Okay? So we're going to talk about in the next couple slides how he did that. So here again are the two ideas, and this was actually a retrospective published in 2007 by Ed Perl. And here is the concept again of the specificity theory versus the intensity theory, where in the specificity theory you have, at least theoretically, but now we know in fact, a set of neurons that do not respond to innocuous stimulation at all, but only respond to intensities once you get into the noxious range. And those neurons were the special subset of neurons within the dorsal root ganglion were referred to and are still referred to as nociceptors. Okay? The competing theory was the intensity theory, and that's that there was no specificity in these neurons. All the neurons in the dorsal root ganglion and trigeminal ganglion are essentially the same, and that they can all respond to innocuous and noxious stimuli, but what happens is that this is coded by the number of action potentials that the neurons will fire. Okay? So he tested this by doing electrophysiology in animals and in human skin, actually, looking at whether or not neurons responded to specific types of stimuli or just showed different intensities depending on the stimuli. And this is from one of his papers that he published in the 1960s. So this was in 1967. This was when he was still at the University of Utah. And what this demonstrates is that if you stimulate the skin with different intensities, you actually see that there's a set of neurons that respond to one type of stimuli, and there's another set of neurons that responds to the other type of stimuli. So in A here, they're probing the skin with just a blunt probe, okay? So like you take the end of your pencil, not the sharp end of your pencil, and you just touch yourself on your hand, right? That's basically what they're doing here. And you can see that this particular neuron that they're recording from doesn't respond, okay? So this neuron does not respond to low threshold stimulation. Here, what they're doing is they're pinching the skin, right? So it's got they have a serrated forceps, and they're pinching the skin. So that's painful, right? It's not extremely painful, but it's painful. If you did this to the person sitting next to you, they wouldn't be happy with you, and I don't encourage you to do it. So here you can see that if they pinch the skin, that this neuron responds, okay? So it only responds to a high threshold stimuli. So that's actually how we classify these neurons now. We classify the low threshold neurons, which we usually refer to now as A-beta fibers, as the ones that are responsible for the detection of light touch. And then the C and A-delta fibers are high threshold receptors, and they respond to intense mechanical stimulation, painful mechanical stimulation, and temperature. Okay. It turns out that these neurons actually are biochemically quite different. They're also quite different in terms of other things, like their myelination status, etc., okay, which we'll talk about a lot today. They're also different in the way that they innervate the skin. So we now know that C fibers, for instance, largely just form free endings in the skin. They come almost all the way out to the surface of your skin, whereas A beta fibers mostly are innervating structures like Meissner corpuscles, et cetera, within the deeper layers of the skin. Okay? And that ultimately determines what kind of sensations they're able to detect. So that's basically what's shown here. So we now largely classify sensory neurons that are found in either the dorsal root ganglion or the trigeminal ganglion. And if you're not familiar with what the dorsal root ganglion or trigeminal ganglion is, don't worry, we're going to get to that in a couple slides, okay? We divide these into three classes, roughly, sometimes four. The A-beta fibers, the C fibers, and the C fibers are further divided into other classes, which we'll talk about today, and the A-delta fibers. So what do these things do? Well, A-beta fibers mostly innervate structures in the skin. They can be found around hair follicles, they can be found on Meissner's corpuscles, Merkel's disc, things like that, okay? Merkel cells, which are here. So these are almost exclusively involved in the detection of light touch. they are also heavily myelinated. So that myelination status means that their conduction velocity is very rapid. And if you think about the way that this works, it makes sense that it would be like that, right? So if something touches you, or if you're doing something that requires fine motor skills, you need the signal to get to your brain very quickly so that you can get the feedback to your motor system to make it possible for you to do these things that involve fine motor skills, right? So these neurons conduct action potentials very rapidly. They get turned on very rapidly by stimulation, so they're low threshold, but they also adapt very rapidly, okay? So how many of you guys still feel yourself sitting in your seat? Hopefully none of you. Okay, one person does. We'll have to work on that, or maybe we can test your genetics. So most of you don't feel yourself still sitting in your seat because the neurons that tell you that you landed in your seat are rapidly adapting, right? Unless you're moving around in your seat a lot, they will fire action potentials when they're first stimulated, but even though they could potentially continue to be stimulated because your skin is still deflected from your own weight as you sit in your seat, they adapt very rapidly. So in other words, they only will fire a couple of action potentials when they're first stimulated, and then they just turn off. They don't continue to fire action potentials. This is also something that distinguishes C fibers from A beta fibers. So C fibers, unfortunately, don't have that property. So if you stimulate C fibers, for instance, by pinching yourself with a forceps, the pain doesn't go away, right? Those neurons don't adapt. That's why nobody walks around pinching themselves all the time, right? It continues to be painful all the time. So that's a fundamental difference between the A beta fibers and C and A delta fibers, is that A beta fibers are so-called rapidly adapting, whereas C and A delta fibers are either slowly adapting or in some cases don't seem to adapt at all. And for chronic pain, especially with C fibers, that's probably a really important property of these cells, because you would imagine if they could adapt, they would stop firing action potentials. But in most chronic pain situations, they seem to continue to fire action potentials, even firing action potentials when there's no stimulation. So again, we now know that this so-called labeled line is the way that this works. It's not intensity-based. And we know that we have lots of specialized sensory receptors that respond to different kinds of stimuli. So one thing that we're going to do in this class is we're going to talk first about the different kinds of neurons that respond to these kinds of stimuli, which is essentially what we're going to do today. And then we're going to get into the really nitty-gritty details of the molecular transducers for these kinds of stimuli. So we will talk about the specific receptors that are activated by heat to allow you to feel and respond to noxious heat. We'll talk about receptors that respond specifically to noxious cold, etc. We'll even get into some of the details about how some neurons respond to mechanical stimulation. Mechanical stimulation, though, it turns out, is still one of the great mysteries of neuroscience. There have been a couple of mechanically gated channels that have been discovered that are primarily in A-beta fibers. That family of protein is called the piezos. They were discovered by a guy named Arvind Pataputian, who's at Scripps in San Diego, a really, really famous neuroscientist. But we still don't know exactly what channels are responsible for mechanically gated currents and nociceptors. And you know, you can imagine that would be a pretty important thing to know, because you might want to block those to try to reduce mechanical pain in people that have chronic pain. So we'll get into a lot of detail about that. We're going to talk more about A beta and C fibers and A delta fibers today. So again, one of the properties of C fibers is that they don't adapt very well. Okay, so they stay on over a long period of time. So what all of this means is that there is a labeled line, as we say, for different types of sensory information, and these are grossly mediated by different classes of sensory fibers, the A-alpha, the A-beta, the A-delta, and the C-fibers, okay? So there are, I don't want you to get the idea that this is true for all of the sensory systems. There are sensory systems that don't work like this, that actually encode by intensity rather than labeled line. But for the purposes of what we're talking about, which is pain, it seems to be a labeled line. And that labeled line even gets more specific than you might imagine. We'll talk about that towards the end of the lecture, either today or on Tuesday. So why do we need nociceptors? So I think the reason that we need nociceptors is because being able to detect things that can hurt us is critically important. Okay, so how do we know that that is so important? Well, the answer to that question is genetics. So what I'm going to do in the next couple of slides is tell you about some genetic conditions where people do not develop nociceptors at all. And we've identified a number of different genes that are required for nociceptor development and that are required for the function of nociception or nociceptors into adulthood. And those tell us some really interesting things. The other thing that they tell us, though, is that being able to detect noxious insults is really important for survival. So people that have these genetic mutations where they either don't develop nociceptors or their nociceptors are non-functional typically don't live very long. And the reason that they don't live very long is because they injure themselves all the time. They get wounds that don't heal. It turns out nociceptors are also really important for wound healing, so that nociceptors release peptides that help the skin to heal when you have an injury. And many of these people die, unfortunately, very young, usually before 10 years of age. They usually have lost all their fingers and toes by that time, and they die from really severe infections that are not detected, because the way that you detect infections also usually is pain, right? And they're just not able to detect any of these things. So let's now get into some of the detail of some of these mutations. So this picture is from a child that has a mutation in a receptor called the tyrosine receptor kinase type A receptor. So that receptor is a receptor tyrosine kinase. What that means is that it's a cell surface receptor, but it's also a kinase, okay? So for those of you guys that have had cellular neuroscience already, hopefully you know what those are because we talked about them in that class. If you haven't, basically this is a signal transduction molecule. And it's activated by an endogenous ligand. And the endogenous ligand for the TrkA receptor is a growth factor called nerve growth factor. So nerve growth factor is absolutely required for the development of the peripheral nervous system, specifically for the development of nociceptors. It also plays a key role in the development of acetylcholine neurons and some other kinds of neurons in the brain. And people that have this mutation in TrkA, it's a fairly rare mutation, but there are people in the population that have this. It's also a spontaneous mutation, it's not an inherited mutation. They lack nociceptors altogether because they don't develop. They have no way to respond to NGF, so they require NGF for their survival during embryonic development, and they're born, but then the neurons are born, but then the neurons die, okay? So they also lack sweat glands because sweat glands are also dependent on NGF. And they have brain developmental problems that lead to a fairly serious intellectual disability, okay? So these people have lots of different things wrong with their nervous system. Yeah.
Is it more common to lose all your nociceptors or certain types?
So this particular mutation leads to the loss of all nociceptors. So during really early development, all nociceptors are dependent on NGF for their survival. As you develop in very early life, most sensory neurons lose their dependency on NGF, and then in adulthood, they don't require NGF for their continued survival. There are no mutations that I'm aware of that lead to a selective loss of only a certain class of nociceptors, but we are going to talk about a different type of mutation that has a totally different type of phenotype.
Okay.
in a couple slides. Actually, it's right here, the NaV1.7 mutations. So this TRK-A mutation is not fatal at birth, but again, people that have this mutation usually don't live past about 10 years of age. People that have a mutation in the voltage-gated sodium channel NaV1.7, which we'll talk about in more detail in a few slides, have a totally different type of phenotype. So they do develop nociceptors. They have nociceptors. Their skin is innervated by C fibers. If you take a skin biopsy from these people, you can see that there's free nerve endings in their skin. But their nociceptors are non-functional. So there's a couple of different theories about why that's the case, but I think the leading one is that this particular voltage-gated sodium channel is required for action potential conductance in nociceptors. So basically, you can generate a generator potential in the periphery in the absence of this functional channel, but you cannot conduct an action potential all the way to the central nervous system. So you can stimulate nociceptors in the skin, but those nociceptors fail to conduct the signal to the brain, so those people don't feel pain for that reason. This is a particularly interesting sodium channel that has mutations that go in the positive and negative direction. So we're going to talk about that in the next slides.
Question.
Yes.
So with that person that has a mutation in that 1.7, would their reflexes work since that doesn't
because it doesn't conduct even to the spinal cord, and those reflexes are mediated in the spinal cord. Yes?
Sorry,
did everybody hear the question? Okay, so the question was, do people that have NaV1.7 loss of function mutations still have reflexes? In other words, if they put their hand on a stove, will they still be able to withdraw, but just not have a pain experience? And the answer to the question is no. And the reason the answer to the question is no is because that's actually a spinal reflex. So it doesn't require a functional brain to remove your hand from a hot stove, but it does require connections in the spinal cord to activate the motor system. So they can't conduct the action potential, at least theoretically, to the spinal cord, so you don't activate the circuit. I'll tell you guys a little bit more about one of the families that they discovered this in as we talk about these next couple slides. But you had a question too, right?
So for the people with the mutation at 1.7, would you be able to simulate any painful response if you tap into any part of the spine or the brain?
Okay, let me go through these two slides and then I'll try to answer that question. So the question was, in people that have a loss of function NaV1.7 mutation, can you simulate pain through some other mechanism, right? Okay, I can't really answer the question, but I'll tell you a little other story that I think you might think is interesting from that perspective, okay? All right, so SCN9A is the gene name for NaV1.7, and NaV1.7 is a voltage-gated sodium channel. So these are the channels that are found in neuronal membranes that can help conduct action potentials. There are many different types of voltage-gated sodium channels, and in the brain, the major ones are NaV1.6 and NaV1.1. Okay. In the peripheral nervous system, the major ones are different. They're NaV, especially in nociceptors. In those cells, they are NaV1.8, NaV1.6 to some extent, and NaV1.7. Okay, so we have these sensory neuron, not totally specific, but fairly specific voltage-gated sodium channels, and they're enriched in nociceptors. Another gene, NaV1.8, is really only found in nociceptors and not in other cells at all. And we'll get into NaV1.8 in a lot of detail in the next lecture. Okay, so NaV1.7 is found in some other areas, but it's really highly enriched in the dorsal root ganglion and the trigeminal ganglion, where it's primarily expressed in nociceptors. And Steve Waxman who's an author on here somewhere, Jeff Woods and John Wood have done really amazing work in looking at people that either have what was previously thought to be genetic but idiopathic spontaneous pain, or that don't feel pain at all. Okay, and what they have found over about a decade of work now is that there are both gain-of-function mutations and loss-of-function mutations in NaV1.7. The gain-of-function mutations cause hyperactivity of these channels. They basically increase their responsiveness at non-noxious temperatures, and that causes the neurons to be hyperexcitable and causes people to have pain all the time. Okay, so the gain of function causes pain without any kind of injury. The loss of function causes people to not have pain at all. Okay, so that's what we call congenital insensitivity to pain. So TRK-A mutations can cause congenital insensitivity to pain. NaV1.7 loss of function mutations can cause congenital insensitivity to pain. And in the last 2 years, we've discovered a couple more genes that can cause congenital insensitivity to pain. So there's an expanding number of rare mutations that can cause this. All right, so what happens when you have the gain of function? Well, the NaV1.7 activity increases. Sorry, this is just showing you where some of these mutations can happen. The two primary diseases caused by gain of function are inherited erythromyalgia and paroxysmal extreme pain disorder. So inherited erythromyalgia essentially refers to the fact that these people seem to have extreme changes in blood flow in their extremities when they have these pain episodes. So essentially what happens is their hands or feet and arms and, their feet and legs and arms and hands can turn pretty intense red when they have one of these pain episodes. And we now know why that happens. It happens because the nociceptors are active, and nociceptors release neuropeptides that cause blood flow increases. Those neuropeptides are CGRP and substance P. We'll talk about those also in a couple more lectures. Okay. So this particular disorder has also previously been called man on fire, and it was called man on fire because the people literally look like they're on fire, and the skin can become very intensely red, as you'll see. Well, I'll show you right now. That is a picture of somebody with erythromyalgia. Yeah, it doesn't look fun, does it? So that is caused by these particular mutations. They're just point mutations, and what they do is they just fundamentally change the biophysical properties of the channel so that it's activated much more easily. This one, paroxysmal extreme pain disorder, is a little bit different. People that have this typically have pain in the mouth and the anus. Okay, so you can't really probably imagine anything worse than that, right? So it's really terrible. So why these mutations lead to pain in a different part of the body is a huge mystery. Nobody has a good answer for that. There are this whole other series of mutations. They have essentially the same kind of effects on the biophysics of the channel. They increase its activity, cause it to be activated with less depolarization, and change its temperature sensitivity. But it's weird. They have effects on completely different parts of the body. This disease mostly on hands and feet and legs and arms, and this on in the oral cavity and in the anus. So then we have these other congenital insensitivity or indifference to pain, which most of these are either point mutations or they're truncations. So they lead to the generation of a non-functional NaV1.7. So the next slide shows you what people that have the inherited erythromyalgia mutation look like. And here again, this is probably the best example of this erythema, which is the reddening of the skin. And this is all caused not by, you know, an immune response or something like that. It's caused by the nociceptors being activated and releasing these neuropeptides that increase the blood flow in the skin. So that is NAV1.7. Now, you asked a question about whether you could simulate pain in the people that had the loss of function mutation. So I told you that one theory of why people that have NAV1.7 loss of function mutations is that the nociceptors are unable to conduct action potentials. So that theory has recently been challenged by John Wood's group, who was one of the people that discovered this. And his theory is a little bit different. His theory is that for some reason, loss of NAV1.7 function leads to increased synthesis of opioid peptides in the peripheral nervous system. And what happens is that instead of there being a loss of action potential generation or conductance, what actually happens is that those opioid peptides tonically inhibit the nociceptors all the time. So they did an experiment in an individual that had congenital insensitivity to pain. They gave them a drug that's called naloxone. Have you guys ever heard of naloxone before? Probably. Everybody talks about this now with the opioid epidemic, right? So naloxone is a really important clinical drug. Naloxone is the drug that would be used in the hospital if an anesthesiologist gave you too much opioid, because it's an antagonist of the opioid receptors and it reverses respiratory depression, which can kill you from opioid, taking too much opioid like that. Okay? It's also increasingly used in the community as more and more people are dying from opioid overdoses. So there's a lot of movements in many states now to basically get naloxone into the hands of people that are getting large doses of opioids because they have prescriptions or that have opioid addiction, right? So that them and their family and friends can administer naloxone should they need it, because it will save their life. It's probably the only thing that will save their life, actually. So naloxone can also be used experimentally, and that's what they did in the study. So they took somebody that had congenital insensitivity to pain. They had some evidence from a mouse model that this could be the case, and they gave that person a dose of naloxone with the idea that now they should be able to feel pain for the first time in their life. Okay? And they published a paper claiming that it's true, right? So that person apparently was able to detect pain only when they gave them naloxone, suggesting that their theory, that this is an opioid-driven event, is correct. So like all things in science, I think it's going to take a long time to actually figure this out, but it's a really interesting and very unexpected idea, and you know that you can do experiments to try to figure it out like that.
Yes. So if you wanted to like inhibit pain, mm-hmm. you give some of this opioid peptide?
Yeah, so I mean, so the question was, if you wanted to inhibit pain, you could give somebody an opioid peptide. Well, I mean, that is the primary way that we treat pain. So they're usually not peptides that are used, they're agonists of the opioid receptors, but the endogenous molecules are peptides, right? So we'll talk about that in a couple lectures. But good job, yes. Yeah?
I have an odd question. Is yeah? Condition in NAV1.7, how come one of the other receptors, like NAV1.8, like, doesn't
exist? So are you asking, why are there not mutations in NAV1.8 that lead to loss of nociception, etc., or why don't...
not necessarily. Like, if there's a mutation in NAV1.7,
yeah.
Why can you not feel pain sensed by nociceptors that express NAV1.8?
I got it. All right, so Hayan is asking, if you lose NAV1.7, why can't the very high level of NAV1.8 expression that is in those cells replace it? Right. Well, the answer to that may be that you're absolutely right, and NAV1.8 should be able to replace it, but what actually happens is that this increased opioid tone is just suppressing the ability of the nociceptive system to be activated. And the way that you would try to help these people, if you felt like you needed to help them, would be to have them be on naloxone all the time, right? So they could feel pain. The The first NAV 1.7, that brings me to the story I was going to tell. So the first NAV 1.7 loss of function mutation was discovered in a family in Pakistan. There's actually a PBS special, it's a Nature special, airs on PBS, about this finding in this family. They went to Pakistan and interviewed them and everything. So the males in this family are circus performers, and they do stuff that you would not believe. They literally put swords through their arms, etc. They basically can do anything that they want because they don't feel pain, right? So in this documentary that they did about the family, I mean, you just see amazing things. And most of the males in the family also don't live very long. Now, with the TRK loss of function, the phenotype is a lot more severe because there's a really severe intellectual disability. And the NAV 1.8 mutations don't seem to cause anything like that. But most of the men in this particular family died from traumatic events relatively early in their life. They tell a story in there, one in particular, that died jumping off a like three-story roof or something like that, because he thought he was basically, you know, impervious to injury. He was only impervious to the pain of injury, though. So, really fascinating stuff. Okay, so we'll stop with the mutation talk now and get more into the anatomy. So, again, we break these different types of sensory neurons into three basic categories: the C fibers, the A delta fibers, and the A beta fibers. The A beta fibers are responsible for the detection of tactile stimulation, light tactile stimulation, and the A delta and the C fibers are really responsible for the detection of noxious stimulation. So they respond to things like acid, heat, cold, strong pressure, and exogenous and endogenous chemicals that cause pain, okay, like inflammatory mediators, for instance. They also project to different areas of the spinal cord, but we'll talk about this in more detail in the second quarter of the course, so we'll not touch on that so much right now. So if you look at a peripheral nerve in section and do electron microscopy or something like that, these different types of fibers are pretty easy to spot. And they're pretty easy to spot because they have different sizes and they have different myelination statuses. So in the cartoon here, the A-beta fibers are in yellow and the myelin is in gray around them. The C fibers are in red here and the A-delta fibers are in blue. And then here's the electron micrograph, right? So here's an A-beta fiber. The A-beta fibers have larger caliber axons, so that they're bigger, okay? They also are very heavily myelinated. So this black that you see here is actually the myelin sheath. So you can see the Schwann cell itself here, and then the myelin sheath is here. So those cells produce a really thick sheath around these A-beta fibers. You can see a delta fiber here, so those stand out because they are myelinated, but the myelin sheath is not as thick, so you can see that, hopefully appreciate that pretty readily compared to the A-beta fibers that are around. So here's another A-beta fiber, for instance. So not as thick, so these are what we call lightly myelinated, and the axon caliber is smaller, okay? And then we have the C fibers. So these are C fibers. There's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 of them in this bundle. This is a nucleus of a cell. That cell is a Schwann cell. So there is really no such thing in a peripheral nerve as a cell, an axon that's not associated with Schwann cells. The difference is that some Schwann cells are myelinating and other Schwann cells are not myelinating, okay? We call this thing here a REMAC bundle, okay? So Schwann cells that essentially come together and hold a bunch of C-fiber axons together and don't myelinate them form what we call REMAC bundles, okay? And then these myelinating Schwann cells, typically it's just one Schwann cell for each piece of myelin that's on these axons, okay? So these REMAC bundles are actually very important because they provide some structure to the axons as they're coursing out to where they're going to go. And there are many neuropathies where if you look at the ultrastructure of the nerve, you can see that the REMAC bundles are disrupted. So they probably play some structural and as well as functional role in maintaining the health of these axons, and disrupting them can cause certain types of neuropathies. So again, we have our C fibers in the REMAC bundles, A beta fibers, which are large and heavily myelinated, A delta fibers are lightly myelinated. So what does that mean? The amount of myelin and the size of the axon determines how fast the conduction velocity will be for an action potential. So again, A beta fibers have a very fast conduction velocity. They convey mostly light touch and vibration. There is some indication that some of these can take on nociceptive like qualities after nerve injury and may be involved in neuropathic pain. Okay? There are also what we call A fiber nociceptors. Some of them are A delta fibers, but some of them are physiologically A beta fibers. So they have very fast conduction velocities, but they respond to noxious stimuli. Not very many of them, but there are some. A delta fibers, again, these are myelinated nociceptors. They're relatively fast conducting. They mostly convey kind of pricking type pain in response to punctate stimuli or intense changes in temperature, like the drop in temperature we had today in about an hour. So these guys often conduct what we refer to as fast pain, okay? And I'll describe that in a little bit more detail in what I think is the next slide. So the nociceptive C fibers are different because they're unmyelinated. So don't get that confused with not being associated with a Schwann cell. They are still associated with Schwann cells. They're just not myelinated, okay? They are slow conducting, and they convey what we often refer to as slow burning, or more commonly, aching type pain. These neurons are also very often what we call polymodal, okay? So that's a really important word for thinking about the peripheral nervous system and nociceptors. What does it mean? It means that they respond to different kinds of stimuli. So here the kind of labeled line thing breaks down to some extent. So some of these will respond to high threshold mechanical stimulation as well as temperature as well as to chemicals. And those are what we classically refer to as polymodal nociceptors. There are some nociceptors that are mechanically sensitive and thermally insensitive. Those are what we call mechanically sensitive nociceptors, and there are other ones that are thermally sensitive but mechanically insensitive. Those are what we call thermally sensitive nociceptors. But most nociceptors are actually polymodal. Okay, they can respond to both mechanical stimulation and temperature in the noxious. Another important thing about all of these sensory neurons is they're different looking than most axons or most neurons in the central nervous system that have both axons and dendrites. These neurons in the dorsal root ganglion or trigeminal ganglion all have their cell body in the dorsal root ganglion itself. They send out a single axon, which is why they have this name pseudo-unipolar, and that axon then bifurcates and goes towards the periphery, usually towards the skin, but they can also have free nerve endings in organs, and also to the central nervous system, where they connect up with neurons in the dorsal horn of the spinal cord or in the brainstem to transduce signals to the other areas of the brain, okay, through second-order neurons, which will be the topic for the second quarter of the class. So the DRG, or the dorsal root ganglion, is the source of all of the sensory neurons that innervate all of your skin, all of your joints, almost all of your muscle, and the majority of your organs. The trigeminal system, which is found just underneath your brain, innervates the dura, which is the covering of your brain, and also most of your face and head. Okay, so the focus of all of the neurons that we'll talk about in this first quarter of the course is going to be DRG and trigeminal ganglion neurons. Okay. So if you look at the kind of fine structure of these things very close to the spinal cord, you will note that the dorsal root ganglion is on the dorsal side, okay? So the dorsal side is actually this side of you, right? So the DRGs are sitting on the, or like in between the vertebrae. The vertebrae have these rami that come off of them. And the DRGs are kind of nestled in there in between those bones. So they're protected by those bones, but they're on the kind of back side of you, okay? And then on the ventral side here is where the motor neurons come out, okay? So the incoming information is going in on the dorsal side into the dorsal horn of the spinal cord, and then the motor information is found on the ventral side of the spinal cord, and these come out. If you look in the nerve itself, like in the sciatic nerve, for instance, which is going down your leg, there are both sensory and motor fibers in there. Okay, so these guys all are going to join up at some time, and they course together out through the nerves, and then eventually the motor nerves will break off and innervate muscle, and the sensory nerves are going the opposite direction, right, coming from your skin or your muscle or wherever it is that they're innervating. Again, we'll get into a lot of detail about how the spinal cord works in the second quarter of the course. These sensory fibers go out and innervate the body through what we call dermatomes. Okay, so here it's shown for the body, and then here it is for the face. So for the body, all of these are coming from the dorsal root ganglion. And if you see these letters and numbers that are shown on here, that's the spinal cord level at which the DRGs are found. Okay. So for instance, what's shown here is that like the back part of your head, like right here, is innervated by the cervical 2 dorsal root ganglion. And then it goes all the way down to cervical 8, which is basically like the bottom part of your shoulder and back of your arm. Then you get the thoracic DRGs starting with T1 down to T12. There are 12 of them in human beings. And then the lumbar DRGs. These are the ones that get messed up the most often because they're in the lumbar part of our spine, which is not really built for aging. As hopefully you don't learn when you get older, but I've certainly learned it. So that's L1 through L5. You may see, if you decide to go and read some of the papers that I posted for this course, that there's a lot of talk about the L6 DRG. So in rodents, they actually have 6 lumbar DRGs, but humans only have 5, okay? The biggest one in rodents is L6. The biggest one in humans is L5. Okay, so in rodents we often use the L6. In humans, though, there is no such thing as the L6. So don't get confused when you see L6 in these rodent papers. That's the one that many of us use frequently. It also is the one that's primarily innervating the paw, which is where we do a lot of our stimulation if we're doing behavioral experiments. And then you have some of the sacral DRGs that mostly are going to be innervating around your rear and the genitalia, okay? So here's for the face. So the trigeminal ganglion is divided into 3 divisions, the V1, the V2, and the V3, and those divisions all have names. The V1 is the ophthalmic division, there. The V2 is the maxillary. So it's called the maxillary, well, the V1 is called the ophthalmic because it innervates your eyes, okay? So the cornea is actually one of the most densely innervated structures in your whole body, and the cornea is only innervated by nociceptors. Has anybody ever looked at a cornea, by the way? The innervation of the cornea? It's amazing. There are this totally uniform, distribution of free nerve endings all along the cornea. They're all spaced like almost exactly the same distance from each other. It's totally mind-blowing. Anyway, so V1 is the ophthalmic, V2 is the maxillary, so it gets the maxillary part of your jaw, also all of your teeth, and then or at least your top teeth, and the V3 is the mandibular, so it gets the mandibular part of your jaw and all your mandibular teeth. The inside of your teeth are another area that's amazingly well innervated, and the entire innervation of your teeth are also C-fiber nociceptors. So if you have ever had the pleasure of having one of your teeth opened up for some reason and then stimulated it, you might have noted that the only thing you feel there is pain, pretty intense pain. you don't feel like a gentle light touch. That's because there are no A-beta fibers on the inside of your teeth. They are all C-fibers. So, there are also some proprioceptive neurons in the trigeminal complex that are found inside the brain. So the only sensory neurons that are found inside the brain are in these mesencephalic trigeminal nucleus that's basically on the way up into the cerebellum. When you take neuroanatomy, you'll learn about those. They're all A-beta fibers. They're involved in the jaw opening reflex. We're not going to talk about it in this class. So. But in neuroanatomy, be sure you know that. It's also a good MCAT question. So. About 80% of you guys care about the MCAT. Mesencephalic nucleus of 5. This is showing you the same thing in more detail about where these DRGs are found and what the dermatome is. So you see DRGs are basically getting the entire body except your face and the back part of your head. The other thing that's innervated by the trigeminal is the dura, which is the part of the covering of the brain. You guys that work in the lab study migraine, and when Greg Dussor comes in here and talks about migraine, he's going to talk about the dura and the trigeminal innervation of the dura a lot. Okay? So this is showing you all the other dermatomes for all of the other levels, all the thoracic, cervical up here as well, lumbar, and then the sacral. So we have many types of different sensory neurons, as I mentioned before. What we're going to do in the next couple of slides is we're going to start talking about the subdivisions of nociceptors. Okay, how do we divide up the nociceptors into different classes, and what are some of the markers that we use to look at these neurons? But first, what time is it? Let's go through like the next two slides, and then I think we'll stop. That'll be good to stop. So, what this slide does is basically tell you what kind of structures A-alpha and A-beta fibers innervate. So, I always get kind of confused about A-alpha designation because people use this term for different things depending on what the book is. I think the easiest way to think about A-alpha fibers is that what they really do is they innervate muscle spindles, okay? So A-alpha fibers are really the large sensory neurons, large diameter sensory neurons, very heavily myelinated, that are involved in tendon reflexes, okay? So when you go to the doctor's office and they test your reflex, that's what they're stimulating, is the A-alpha fibers, okay? A-beta fibers innervate really richly your skin, and they almost never form free nerve endings though in the skin. They innervate different types of structures like Meissner's corpuscles, Merkel's discs, Pacinian corpuscles, Ruffini endings, hair follicle terminals, and these guys are almost exclusively or exclusively involved in detection of things like light touch, vibration, etc. They're not involved, at least in non-pathological states, in the detection of pain. And then here we start talking about thermal receptors, either cool or warm or heat, that are found on either A-delta or C-fibers, but we'll give you a lot more detail about this. We'll talk about the specific receptors that detect these things and what type of populations of neurons they're found in. We have really good information about that for the temperature detectors because we know their molecular identity. So you can look at a cell and ask whether or not it expresses that kind of channel, and you know whether or not it's going to be responding to that kind of temperature. Unfortunately, for mechanical stimuli, we don't know what these are. So we know what the channels are in many of these A-beta fibers. They're piezos. Specifically, they seem to mostly be piezo too, right? But in these, we don't know exactly what those mechanical channels are. So this is still one of the big mysteries in neuroscience. And of course, muscle can be innervated both by A-alpha and A-beta fibers and A-delta and C-fibers. So we often talk about the so-called first and second pain. Hopefully this already sunk in because we've talked about it a little bit. But the first pain is mediated by A-delta fibers, and the second pain is mediated by C-fibers. So, you know, in practice, what does this mean? Well, when you wake up in the middle of the night, you go to the bathroom, and you're walking there, and it's dark, and you stub your toe, you know, that feeling, that immediate feeling you get that, oh crap, I stubbed my toe, is the A-delta fibers, and then the thing that makes you curse for the next minute is the C-fibers, okay? So there really is a pretty big gap in between the two, as we all know, right? You know when you get some kind of stimulation that is going to cause you to really hurt, right? And the first one hurts, but it's not near as bad as that aching and burning, right? It's really that aching and burning pain that is the problem in people that have chronic pain, right? Sometimes people have disorders where they get this stinging and kind of pain all the time, but the thing that's really more intense is this kind of aching, burning pain that never goes away. It's also a lot more common, right? So it can happen from persistent inflammation, it can happen from nerve injury, it can be produced by chemotherapeutics. Lots of different things can cause these types of problems. And this happens because the conduction velocity of these neurons are different. So A-beta fibers conduct at a conduction velocity of between 50 and 100 milliseconds, meters per second, sorry. A-delta fibers conduct between 5 and 30 meters per second. And C-fibers are really very slow. They only conduct at about a maximum of about 1 meter per second. Okay. So the other thing that's different about this is that the innervation of the central nervous system by the A-delta fibers and the C-fibers are different. So A-delta fibers have a better somatotopic definition. So this kind of fast pain is actually relatively easy to figure out where it's coming from, right? So when you stub your toe again, you know which toe you hit, right? But when you feel that kind of aching pain, it feels like your whole leg, right? Or at least the whole bottom of your leg. That's because these C-fibers give a more diffuse innervation of the central nervous system, so their somatotopic organization is not quite as good. And that leads to kind of expansion of the area that it feels like the sensation is coming to. And it's also very difficult to estimate just how strong it's going to be, right? So you never quite know when you stub your toe if it's going to hurt for 30 seconds or if it's going to hurt for 10 minutes. As you get older, the time increases, actually. So you have that to look forward to. All right, so now we're going to get into how you define the different classes of nociceptors, and this is a really good breaking point. So I'm going to stop here, but if you guys have any questions, I can take them. Perfectly clear lecture. All right, you can listen to it again. All right, have a good weekend, everybody. Don't